Ok, partage d'écran. Hop. Ok, so good day everyone. So this is our fifth lecture. Our fifth lecture, and this time we are going to talk about Synapseed Evolution. So as usual, download this video and take notes to facilitate your work. So the synapseeds are characterized by a single temporal fenestra located on the side of the skull in the lower position. So that's what you can see here in this basal synapseed, and this is the place of the temporal fenestra on a human skull. So if you look at the human skull, you can see the jugal arch, which is there. So that's your jugal arch, and your temporal fenestra is located in the space here that you have just behind the orbit. So you have your eye, and it's that space here. So here, that's the equivalent of the temporal fenestra in human. It serves as passage for the temporal muscle. So the muscle you can feel if you do that. You can feel a muscle moving right here, just above the jugal arch, and that's your temporal muscle. And the temporal muscle goes through the fenestra, which is below here, and goes to attach on your lower jaw here. Also, the synapseids all share the presence of a canine. So one of the tooth is more developed than the others, and separate the dentition between the pre-canine dentition, so what we call the incisors, and the post-canine dentition, which we call the molars in mammal. Molars and premolars. Also, the synapseids will be characterized by a transformation, a very gradual transformation that we will talk about, from the jaw articulation, and that jaw articulation will change into the ossicles, the middle ear ossicles. So the articular will become the malleus, and the quadrate will become the incus. And these bones will transform in a very gradual process of reduction of all the bones that you can see here in the lower jaw. So, but we will see that across this lecture. Now, the basic classification of synapsida. Synapsids are divided into three groups. Two are paraphyletic. First, the pelycosaurs, which are the sprawling synapsids with a very small temporal fenestra, like Eleosaurus from the Permian of South Africa. Then you have the therapsida. The therapsida are your semi-erect synapsids. They originated in the Permian and lived until the Triassic, while the pelycosaurs lived before that, from the Carboniferous to the Permian. And the last group is the mammals. Mammals belong to the synapsida, and they have a fully erect posture. So it's very similar to what's happening with archosaurs, basically. A transition from a sprawling posture to a fully erect posture. And we will also see a gradual increase in the size of the temporal fenestra to the mammalian condition. And the earliest mammals are found in the Jurassic. For example, you have Megazostrodon from the early Jurassic of South Africa. So let's start first with the pelycosaurs. The pelycosaurs are easily identifiable because of their typical curvature of the dorsal margin of the skull. Well, what does that mean? It just means that when you look at it from the side, the skull has a curvature of the upper side, basically. So when you look at it from in lateral view, you can see that curvature at the top of the skull. That's typical of pelycosaurs. So for that, they are very easy to identify. Also, they have a very small temporal fenestra. You can see that the temporal fenestra is a lot smaller than the orbit. This will change with Therapsids. The caniniform is present, but it's not very well defined. So you have a caniniform tooth that is just a little bigger, but not so big compared to the other teeth. And they retain the intracranial joint of the primitive sarcopterygian. And we will see that this intracranial joint will be lost with the therapsida. The occipital condyle is single and convex, like in reptiles. So that's a primitive feature. So if you look at the occipital condyle, you can say that in 60% of the case you're looking at a reptile, but there is a few cases in which you will be looking at a pelycosaur. So the lower jaw has 7 bones. So, and we will see that this number will gradually reduce. And there are a lot of palatal teeth. So this is also a primitive condition. So basically the pelycosaurs are defined by primitive conditions. The small temporal fenestra, the caniniform that is not developed, the presence of the sarcopterygian cranial joint, they retain the single occipital condyle of amniotes, and they have 7 bones in the mandibule and palatal teeth. So here I've colored the palatal teeth on the skull of a pelycosaur, and you can see how much there are palatal teeth on the vomers, there are palatal teeth on the pterygoid, on the palatine, there are palatal teeth on the pterygoid here and there, and on the ectopterygoid here. So there is a lot of palatal teeth. And the pelycosaurs were the first synapsids. They originated as early as the middle Carboniferous, and they made it up to the middle Permian. So they had quite a time. Late Carboniferous. The first pelycosaurs are Archaeotheres and Protoclepsydrops. They are not very well documented, but we know them enough to say that they are good pelycosaurs, and they originated in the late Carboniferous. But it's just a matter of time before we find more pelycosaurs in the beginning of the Carboniferous. And what is interesting about Archaeotheres in particular is that we found scales in Archaeotheres. So it confirms that the evolution of mammals started not with hairs, but with scales. And such a scales are also present in another family called the Varanopidae, when you have osteoderms on the back, like in crocodiles, for example. So you can see these osteoderms are right here. So the Varanopidae is one of the only family of pelycosaurs that had a worldwide distribution. Here you can see the occurrence of most pelycosaurs, and you can see that it's mostly North America and Europe. But the Varanopidae are also found in South Africa. So they are the only one also that did not live in the tropic. Because remember, they live in the Middle Permian. We are not so far from the Devonian. And remember that in the Devonian, Africa was located at the southern pole. So, and South Africa particularly was still very close to the southern pole. In the Middle Permian. So it's one of the few pelycosaurs that was not living close to the pole. And also it's one of the only ones that survived until the Middle Permian. Most pelycosaurs completely went extinct at the end of the early Permian. Varanopids are one of the only two groups that survived to the Middle Permian, but did not make it to the Late Permian anyway. And one last interesting about the Varanopids is the possibility of parental care, because here you have an adult, and here, if you look carefully, there is another skull, there's a juvenile, and here there's another small skull, so it's another juvenile, and here you have again another skull, so a third juvenile. So in total, you have an adult and 1, 2, 3 juveniles in the same assemblage. So maybe this adult was taking care of the juveniles. Another important group of pelycosaur is the Sphenacodontidae, because they are directly ancestral to the therapsids. So they are the stepping stone to the next chapter, to the next paragraph of this lecture. So the sphenacodontidae share with more derived therapsids a couple of characters. So first of them is a shorter lacrimal. If you look at any other synapsid, any other pelycosaur, you will see that the lacrimal here goes from the orbit to the nostril. So the lacrimal goes all the way to the nostril, but it's not the case in pelycosaurs like Dimetrodon. In Sphenacodon, Sphenacodontidae, you can see the lacrimal is much shorter because the maxilla is taking over the lateral surface of the skull. Also, pelycosaurs have crenulated teeth, a character that we will find in most therapsids, except the herbivorous ones, of course. And they have distinct tooth sockets. So before that, there was no tooth socket, which, if you remember, is the acrodont condition. But Sphenacodontidae, like the therapsids and like mammals, have a thecodont condition in which there is a tooth socket. Each teeth has a socket in which it is rooted, and all the teeth have roots. Also, in the sphenacodontid, we begin to see the transformation of the lower jaw bones into the middle ear bones, and this is reflected by two characters. First, the dentary elongates, and the dentary becomes the dominant bone of the lower jaw, which was not the case in other pelycosaurs. So in Dimetrodon, for example, you can see that the lateral side of the lower jaw is dominated by the dentary. And there is a reflected lamina of the angular. So the reflected lamina of the angular is a piece of bone located on the angular that create like a small infolding. So view from the side, it looks like almost like this. It's like a piece of bone that sticks out of the angular. So that's the angular bone here. And here you have that piece, that lamina of bone that sticks out from the angular. And this reflected lamina of the angular will ultimately become the tympanic bone of mammals. So here you have to remember your mammalogy class, your paleo mammalogy class, and remember what the tympanic is. It's the auditory chamber by the inner ear. So the angular will become the tympanic, and you can see that the articular is located right behind it, ready to become one of those auditory ossicles. So it's the beginning of the reduction of the post-dentary bone and of the dominance of the dentary bones over the rest of the lower jaw. So the dentary will ultimately become the only bone in the lower jaw. One thing also is that Dimetrodon is famous for its dorsal sail that you can see here. So once again, it was probably used for sexual display. What is important to note is that the dorsal sail is not the usual condition for sphenacodontid or for pelycosaurs in general. Most pelycosaurs did not have a dorsal sail. Like for example, Sphenacodon was basically just like a Dimetrodon, but without a dorsal sail. Since probably some of you may be asking if the dorsal sail was helping at thermoregulation, so at regulating the body temperature. So the question would be, where was Dimetrodon cold-blooded or warm-blooded? One of the elements of answer is found in the distribution of carnivores and herbivores. When you have an ecosystem in which carnivores are dominated by cold-blooded species, like crocodiles, for example, you can feed a lot more crocodiles with a fewer number of herbivores. So you have a lot more cold-blooded carnivores than you have, for example, lions. So when I'm trying to put it simply, but it's not simple. So yeah, when you have an ecosystem that is where the carnivores are cold-blooded, you have much more carnivores. The number of carnivores is a lot higher than in an ecosystem in which the dominant carnivore is warm-blooded. So, and the example is the crocodile. When you have an ecosystem dominate in which the predator, the dominant predator is the crocodile, you can have hundreds and hundreds of crocodiles for just a few gazelles, a few antelopes. But when you have an ecosystem that is dominated by lions, which are warm-blooded, then you have only a dozen of lions for hundreds of antelopes. Why? Because few lions take a lot more food to maintain than a lot of carnivores, a lot of cold-blooded carnivores. Because the cold-blooded metabolism takes a lot less energy to work than a warm-blooded metabolism. So if you apply that now to the fossil record, you find that in the early Permian, the ecosystems were dominated by Dimetrodon and other sphenacodontid, and you see that there are a lot of carnivores compared to the herbivores. And when you turn into the middle and late Permian, you have, particularly in the late Permian, you have a lot more herbivores for a smaller number of carnivores. So maybe here what we can see is that probably the transition from cold-blooded to warm-bloodedness happened between the early and the late Permian. But it's just one of the many indicators of the evolution of warm-bloodedness. So now we move up to the therapsids. So the therapsids, in therapsids, you will find characters that already evolved in sphenacodontid, like the short lacrimal, like the expanded dentary. But the main innovations in therapsids are first the size of the lower temporal fenestra. So the lower temporal fenestra becomes as large, is if not even larger, than the orbit, which was not the case in sphenacodontid yet. And one of the important characters of therapsida is the presence of a bone here that is called the septomaxilla, that is absent in pelicosaurs. So the septomaxilla contributes to the side of the skull while it's absent in pelicosaurs. Also, the intracranial joint is definitely lost, and because of that, the palatal teeth becomes less and less useful. The intracranial joint enables the mobility of the palate, and the mobility of the palate helps swallow the prey by dragging the prey into the throat. But if you don't have any intracranial mobility, it means that the teeth that you use to drag, the palatal teeth that you use to drag the prey inside your throat, are no longer useful. The dentary definitely dominates the lower jaw. So this is your dentary, and you can see that it dominates the lower jaw from the side, on the side, the external side, sorry, like in pelicosaurs, but also on the internal side, with that very big process here that is called the coronoid process. And the reflected lamina also becomes very big, and it's definitely, it will be a very important feature in the classification of therapsida, as we will see later. Finally, therapsida, unlike pelicosaurs, are not sprawling, but they are semi-erect. So the limbs were semi-erect, which implies that the humerus and femur are a little bit less twisted, and because if you're holding your humerus all times like this, you need a twisting between there and here, so that this one has an horizontal articulation, this side has an horizontal articulation, and this side has a vertical articulation. So the humerus and femur are twisted in sprawling animals, But then if you erect, the more you erect your posture, the less you need that twisting. So the twisting is lost. And the articulation surface with the pelvic, with the pelvic and shoulder girdle also becomes a bit deeper, because the femoral and humeral head are becoming more distinct. So this all reflects as adaptation to a semi-erect posture. That's how we know that they are the semi-erect posture. It's not because we've seen them walking, it's because we can analyze the skeleton and see how this character reflects. Also, on the foot and hand, an interesting phenomenon is the reduction of the phalanges. So in the primitive amniotes, you have a phalangeal formula in which you have two phalanges on the thumb, three on the forefinger, four on the third finger, five on the fourth finger, and three or four in the fourth finger. So that results in the fingers becoming gradually bigger from the first finger to the fourth finger. This is no longer the case in therapsids. All the fingers are more or less the same size, because some phalanges in the third and fourth fingers are reduced. So the phalangeal formula is still the same, but now the proportions of the hand and foot becomes closer to that in mammals. And ultimately in mammals, you will have a phalangeal formula of two. So you don't have to remember it. You just look at your hand. Here you have two phalanges, one, two, three, one, two, three, one, two, three, one, two, three. So all your fingers are equal except the thumb, which has two phalanges. And this is the case for every mammals. This is the humans do have the phalangeal formula of all mammals, of the primitive phalangeal formula for mammals. And this is an evolutionary trend that was engaged with therapsids. The oldest therapsid is Raranimus, at least the oldest that we can possibly know for now. It's Raranimus from the Middle Permian of China. It's about 270 million years old. And it's just a snout, but that snout has a very large canine, very distinct. So it's not like in pelicosaurs, in which the canine is not well defined. The canine is very well defined in Raranimus. And you can see here in yellow, that's the septomaxilla of Raranimus, which is also well exposed on the side of the snout. So it's definitely a therapsids from the Middle Permian. And it's also the basalmost. So now this is the classification of therapsids. So therapsids are divided into six families: the Biamosuchia, the Dinocephalia, the Anomodontia, the Gorgonopsia, the Therocephalia, and the Cynodonts. And today we will focus on these three, the Biamosuchia, Dinocephalia, and Anomodonts. We will look quickly at the Gorgonopsia, but the Gorgonopsia is really a group that will need more work, because we don't know much about them. And next time we will look at the Cynodonts and Therocephalia. So first, the Biamosuchia, very quickly. So it's a group that lived during the Middle and Late Permian. It's a group of therapsids strictly concealed to the Middle and Late Permian. We don't know much about them, because they were only recognized as a different group in 1986. Before that, they were classified as Gorgonopsians. They are extremely rare. We don't even know if they are truly monophyletic. And for a very simple reason, is that the primitive Biamosuchian, you can see from that skull, have the typical curvature of pelicosaurs. So they look very much like pelicosaurs. The only thing that distinguish them from pelicosaur is their large temporal fenestra and their very distinct canine. So that curvature of the skull is very pelicosaurian in aspect. So they are classified as therapsid because of their canine and large temporal fenestra. And the other thing is that you have the most derived Birmosuchians here, which are called the Burnetia morph, like Para Burnetia. And these ones have bosses and horns everywhere on their skull. So they have a boss on their snout, a boss above the orbit, a boss above the temporal fenestra, a boss below the temporal fenestra. So they have bosses everywhere. And yeah, there's not much things that are shared between the two. They don't look very much like each other, except they look primitively like each other, particularly the morphology of their palate. But probably in the very near future, we will find out that Birmosuchian is actually not a thing. So let's see for the future. The second group, and probably one of the most important, is the Deinocephalia. So Deinocephalia first are very important for stratigraphy because they are only found in the middle Permian. So there is an assemblage zone. There is a biozone that is defined only after them, the Tapinocephalus assemblage zone, because that's the only slice of time in which we find Deinocephalians in the Karoo. So those Deinocephalians are extremely important for biostratigraphy. Also, they are a very good index fossil biostratigraphic marker because they have a worldwide distribution. Deinocephalians are found on almost every continent, South America, Africa, and Asia particularly. And they are very, very abundant. They preserve well because their bones are extremely pachyostotic. So that's what is written there. The skull is pachyostotic, but very often the skeleton will also show some degree of pachyostosis. So the whole body can be extremely thick and robust. They show intermeshing incisors. So that's one of the best defining character of Deinocephalian. So if you look at the incisor, for example, of Antiosaurus here, you can see that there's one incisor up, one incisor down, one incisor up, one incisor down. So the incisors are intermeshed like this. We talked about that in crocodiles also. But here it's only the incisors. It's not all the teeth like in crocodiles. And the nostrils are non-terminal, which means that instead of having the nostrils at the top of the snout, the nostril is always a bit retracted here. And some people think that this reflects a semi-aquatic habitat like hippopotamuses. It's very, very debated. They show a lot of adaptation to life on land, actually. Deinocephalia are divided into two groups, the herbivores and the carnivores. So the carnivore group is called the Anteosauria, or sometimes you will find it referred to in the literature as the Brithopia. So the Anteosauria are the carnivorous one with a very large canines, super big incisors, almost no or very few postcanines. So these things were just chucking, they were just tearing a bit of their prey and swallowing it, munching it raw, like without chewing. So they were not adapted for chewing. That's basically what it says. And their skull is pachyostotic only around the orbit and on the post-orbital bar. So you can see there's a small boss here around the orbit and a bit of the jugal arch. So the skull has a limited pachyostosis. Limited to the circumorbital region, so that region around here. And they have a very large temporal fenestra because they had a very large temporal muscle for very powerful jaw muscles. So they had a very powerful bite, if anything. And the skeleton in general, for what we know, was not extremely, extremely pachyostotic. So the postcranial skeleton was more gracile than in the next group, which is the Tapinocephalia. The Tapinocephalia had a very big, massive skeleton compared to the to the anterosauria. This is, for example, the skeleton of a Tapinocephalia, Tapinocaninus, discovered by John Niapulli from the Bloemfontein, from the museum in Bloemfontein. So you can see that that one has a massive, massive skeleton. So Tapinocephalia have a massive skeleton, and they are characterized mostly by their dentition. They are characterized by their adaptation to herbivory. So the talon and heel morphology, that's what you see here. So the teeth, it's not just one point. It's one point plus a basin, which is called the heel, and the teeth were basically crushing the vegetation with the talon and heel morphology. So you have that's by the way a very nice co-option of the intermeshing morphology that I told you about before. And they have a very broad palate, so they have a very broad mouth, and with this broad mouth they could chew their food more efficiently. And the Tapinocephalia are divided into two groups. So the herbivorous Dinocephalians are divided into two groups, the Titanosuchidae and the Tapinocephalidae. The Titanosuchidae, they look, if you look for picture of the Titanosuchidae, you can look for Junkeria. And by the way, I think I can do that. Huh? We are among us. So if you want to look at the Junkeria, you Google Junkeria skull, and you can find the picture of a nice Junkeria skull, and you can see it's very funny. It looks like a duck bill. So you can see the snout is very broad. It's an adaptation to herbivorous, to an herbivorous diet. So Junkeria is the typical, it's the typical Titanosuchid. It differs from the Tapinocephalid because it has the talon and heel morphology on the incisors only. The canine is still there, and the postcanine are not specialized. On the other hand, you have the Tapinocephalid, in which the talon and heel morphology has taken over the whole dentition, and as a consequence, there's no more canine. So the canine is no longer visible in Tapinocephalid. And also, the Tapinocephalins are the ones in which you see the most extensive pachyostosis with large horns and boss and the massive body. So here is, for example, Moschops or Moschops. So the talon and heel morphology is on all the teeth. There is no canine. And you can see the body is gigantic. And here you can see this is a slice through the skull of Moschops, so a slice that has been taken there through the brain case. And here you can see there's something like 15 centimeter of pure bone separating the outside from the brain case here, like 15 centimeters. It's gigantic. So this thickened bone is an adaptation to headbutting. So they were using their head to smash into each other like this. And now if you think about the evolution of Dinocephalians, you have the carnivores that have very big canines but no cranial ornamentation, and you have the herbivores that have no canine but very big ornamentation on their skull, a very thick skull to fight each other. And this is kind of reminiscent of what happens in cervids, for example. So here you have some deers. And you can see that some deers have very big antlers, but they have no canine, and some deers have a very large canines to fight each other, but they have no antler. So this is probably, we are probably looking at the same phenomenon in Tapinocephalian. Another group of herbivorous therapsids now, and probably the most important of all, at least in terms of diversity, it's the Anomodontia. The Anomodontia, it's probably the most diverse group with more than 300 species that have been described, probably a lot more still to describe, and adaptations to every type of environment. You have very small Anomodontia with scale size about this. We have very big Anomodonts that are the size of an elephant. We have we have a gigantic diversity of these animals. Some of them climb trees, like Suminia, for example. It's this one. It has a sharp claws to climb trees. Some of them have hooves and they are adapted to running, and some of them lived in a semi-aquatic habitat. So we will see all that diversity during the presentation of the Anomodonts. But yeah, remember that the Anomodonts is the best evolutionary success of therapsids, if you exclude mammals, of course. It's the biggest evolutionary success. So how do you identify an Anomodont? Because of its adaptation, of their adaptation to herbivory, which are different from that of dinocephalians. So first, the serrations are absent from the teeth. Second, the zygomatic arch is bowed and displays dorsally, so it is very well visible there in Suminia and in that dicynodont called Lystrosaurus. So you can see this is the dorsal displacement of the jugal arch, and you can see how it bows here at the back, and same thing in Suminia, the bowing here. So here you're looking at Patranomodon, which is one of the basal most anomodonts, and in this one you can see that the dorsal displacement is less important. Here you have the tooth, the level of the teeth, the dental margin, and you can see that compared to the dental margin, there's a slight dorsal displacement here with a very not so conspicuous bowing at the back. So it's because it's one of the most primitive anomodonts that we can have. And an important character is the presence of this arrow is misplaced, sorry. Is the presence of a fenestra on the lower jaw. So you can see here, just like in archosaurs, very similar to archosaurs, there is a fenestra on the lower jaw here that you can see also here in Suminia. My arrow doesn't want to, yeah. Here it is in Suminia. You can see it here on the actual skull. This is that fenestra in Lystrosaurus. Of course, there's no lower jaw for Patranomodon, but probably Patranomodon also had a mandibular fenestra. So these are the three characters that defined Anomodonts, and particularly the zygomatic arch bowing. And now the origin of Anomodonts is highly debated. We don't really know where they're coming from, because every continent has its own champion. Africa has Patranomodon in South Africa, Asia has Suminia, and also has Biceridens from the Middle Permian, so it's about as old as Raranimus that we saw earlier. And in America they have Tiara judens from South America, also from the Middle Permian, so they are all about equally as old as each other. Maybe Biceridens is a little older than the others, and they are all equally as primitive. Maybe Suminia is more derived than the others. You can see that its incisors are extremely big. That's an adaptation to herbivory. You can see that Tiara judens also has extremely big teeth, and particularly the canine, which is extremely elongated. So the two best candidate here, I think, are Patranomodon and Biceridens, and for now people prefer to see Biceridens as the most as probably the best candidate for the origin of Anomodonts, because it's a bit older than Patranomodon, but nothing is settled yet. So this is a very simplified classification, and please believe me when I say it's simplified. This is a very, very simplified classification of Anomodonts, and we are going to explore that classification a bit further. So let's start. So we've seen the basal Anomodonts, so the base of that tree here. We've seen Patranomodon. We talked about Tiara judens, which is very similar to Anomocephalus from South Africa. And we talked about Suminia, which is a representative of that Russian clade of basal anomodonts called the Venucovid. So now we are moving to the Dicynodontia. which is the bulk of the anomodont diversity. The Dicynodontia are characterized by their edentulous beak, which most of the time bears a very large tusk. So a tusk is like a canine. It's like a normal oversized canine, but it doesn't have enamel. So if it's only made of ivory or dentin. Remember, dentin and ivory are the same thing. So that's the two characters that define the best, the Dicynodont, the edentulous beak and the tusk. You have another important characteristic is the presence of a secondary palate. So for example, if you look at the palate of this basal anomodont, Anomocephalus, there is no secondary palate. The you can see that the coana is directly attached to the... They directly come out of the premaxilla, but here the premaxilla is slightly expanded backward and forms a small secondary palate. So, and this is the level of the coana here that you can see pushed back, and it pushes even back further in more derived Dicynodont. So here it's the condition in Eodicynodont, the basalmost Dicynodont known, and also the oldest Dicynodont known. And you can see that there is a very short secondary palate. And what's interesting in Dicynodont is that the secondary palate will be formed by the premaxilla only. So only the premaxilla is going back in the mouth to form the secondary palate. One last interesting character in Anomodonts is the presence of a double jaw joint. There are two condyles on the quadrate, so one medial and one lateral. That's what you see here, the two quadrate condyles. So this enables jaw movement for grinding food with the beak back and forth, like this. So what is called the propalinal jaw motion. So the basalmost Dicynodont is Eodicynodont. You can see that it retains small postcanine. And you can see that the premaxilla are not fused in Eodicynodont. So the beak is not completely formed yet in Eodicynodont. So now let's talk about the evolution of the teeth across the Dicynodont. So you can see that on this evolutionary tree that most of the species that retain postcanine teeth are located at the base. So of course, Anomodonts do have postcanine teeth. And then from the Dicynodont, they are starting losing they've lost their premaxillary teeth, but they still retain, some of them still retain postcanine teeth up until the Therochelonia, so which is one of the most derived group of Dicynodont. So all these basal genera retain teeth. And particularly that particular clade in which you find Endothiodon and in Pristerodon, which is the sister group to that clade. So in Pristerodon and Endothiodon, you can see very large postcanine teeth. Pristerodon has two or three rows of teeth on its lower jaw. And in Endothiodon, you even have a tooth battery. You can see that the teeth are renewing in line like this, just like in sharks, actually. It's very similar to sharks. Endothiodon, you can see, also has a very different outline than most of us Dicynodont. It has a very deep dentary, a boss on the jugal, no tusks. So it's a very specialized type of early Dicynodont. And it's actually the earliest very large Dicynodont that we know. The skull is about that big already. So it's one of the first large Dicynodont. And you can see that also it has crenulated teeth. And some people think that if Endothiodon was so special, it's because it was omnivorous and not strictly herbivorous like most of our Dicynodont. Another important feature is sexual dimorphism. So sexual dimorphism, when you see those tusks in Dicynodonts, you're tempted to wonder what these tusks were used for. And one of the most obvious answer is that they were probably used for male to fight each other to conquer territories and mates during the reproduction season. And it was probably the case, at least in some dicynodonts for which sexual dimorphism has been demonstrated. So I've indicated these genera with an arrow. One of the most famous one is Dictodon, which is there. So here you have two specimens of Dictodon, a male and a female. And they definitely belong to Dictodon, to the same genus, because they have the same 90 degree angle between the maxillary process, what we call the caniniform process of the maxilla here, that accommodates the tooth socket. So there is a 90 degree angle between the beak and the maxilla, the canine process, the caniniform process of the maxilla here and there. So you can see a very sharp 90 degree angle that characterizes Dictodon. So there's no doubt that they belong to the same species, and yet one of them has a canine and is interpreted as a male individual, and one of them doesn't and is interpreted as a female. So now let's talk about the ecological diversity, particularly in two clades of Dicynodonts, that are the Hemidopoidea and the Dicynodontia. Why these two clades in particular? We could talk about many other clades, of course. Dictodon, which was a burrower, and we could talk about Suminia, which was a tree climber. But these two clades are the only two that crossed the PT boundary, the Permian-Triassic boundary. So they are their diversity basically saved them from the biggest extinction on Earth. So the first group is the Hemidopoidea. So in Hemidopoidea, there's one species that crosses the PT boundary, and it's Myosaurus here. And the Hemidopoidea are famous for being fossorial animals, fossorial synapsids. So they were not only burrowing, they were really living underground, like moles. So if you look at Hemidops, let's look first at the most derived. So if you start with the most derived Hemidopoidea, like Cowinghasaurus from Zambia, you see that the eyes are very small, and you can see here the deltopectoral crest of the humerus is highly developed, and so that means that there was a lot of power in the pectoral muscle, and it means that the eyes were barely used by this animal. So it's typical of animals that dig in the underground and that live in the dark all the time. You don't need big eyes when you live in the dark all the time. And then when you trace back the phylogeny of Hemidopoid, you find species that have least developed deltopectoral crest. It's still quite developed in Kystecephalus, which is a little less derived. And it's almost not developed in Hemidops, which is the basalmost Hemidopoid. And the same thing if you look at the inner ear. So we know from modern species that reptiles that live in burrows have a very much inflated inner ear that looks like a ball, like this. It's ball-shaped. And here in Cowinghasaurus, you see that inner ear is the same as in a fossorial snake, for example. And same thing, if you trace back the evolution of the inner ear in Hemidopoid, the less the species is derived and the less the inner ear is inflated, up to the point that Hemidops shows no inflation of the inner ear at all. So that's a very remarkable evolutionary trend, a very consistent evolutionary trend that we see in these Hemidopoids. And one of the few Hemidopoids for which we have a complete skeleton is Kystecephalus. And in Kystecephalus, you see that the body is very, very long. The head is very, very flat. And Kystecephalus basically means box head, because the head, the skull, looks like a box when you look at it from the top. And you can see that the bones of the hands and are very flattened and they look like two spoons. Basically, the second and third finger look like two spoons or two shovels that they use to dig out. So that's really remarkable adaptation to live underground. And these are adaptations that you see in many modern fossorial species like moles and naked mole rats, for example. Among dicynodontoid, yeah. So first, how do you recognize a dicynodontoid? The secondary palate is very, very long in dicynodontoid. That's how you identify them. And it's so long that many times it will include component of the maxilla and the palatine. So it's not only the premaxilla. The premaxilla is extremely long, but the secondary palate becomes so long that it also includes the maxilla and the palatine. So it's almost the same evolutionary trend as we see in crocodilomorphs. And in Dicynodontoidea, what's interesting is that in the Daptocephalus zone, so in the late Permian, you find some species that show quite well, not only in the Daptocephalus zone, actually, in the late Permian in general. Just forget about the Daptocephalus zone. It's too soon anyway to talk about the Daptocephalus zone. We'll see that later. So in the late Permian, you have a partition of resources or a partition of ecological niches between species that have a very square snout and that look very much like the grazing rhino, the white rhino, and between species that have a very sharp, pointy beak that very much imitates what we see in the bruising black rhino. So between these species and this species, you can imagine, you can reasonably infer, may I say, that these ones were more grazers and these ones were more bruisers. And you can see that there are even transitional species like Udenodon, for example, and Dicynodon. So that's a very interesting evolutionary trend. And also you can see that the grazer would have much bigger masticatory muscles than the bruiser, which is also something that you would expect because bruising is takes a lot less energy on your masticatory muscles than grazing. And now we move slightly, but eventually to the Triassic with Lystrosaurus. So Lystrosaurus is famous for crossing the PT boundary. We'll talk about that right after this. But Lystrosaurus is also known for being potentially a semi-aquatic species, a hypothesis that was made famous by the BBC documentary Walking with Beasts, if I'm not mistaken. And here you can see a Lystrosaurus being attacked by another PT boundary taxon that we've already seen earlier, the Proterozoicus. So the Lystrosaurus is very interesting because if you compare a Lystrosaurus skull to a Dicynodon skull, you will see that it's just like a Dicynodon skull, but with the snout that has been bended like this, like very strongly, almost 90 degrees. So the snout has been bended and you can see that the nostril is pushed back here, almost at the level of the eye. And this was interpreted as an adaptation to keep the nostrils out of the water when the animal is in the water. And the 90 degree bending of the snout and the snout that finishes with big tusks like in Lystrosaurus are very, very similar to the snout in the dugong, in the modern dugong. So that's why Lystrosaurus is interpreted as an aquatic species. And this has been confirmed by, this is supported, sorry, by the bone density, but I think they performed some isotopic analysis, so some geochemical analysis that were not consistent with an aquatic lifestyle. So this is still an ongoing debate, but the morphology is very consistent with a semi-aquatic species. And also, Lystrosaurus is very famous for being one of the few taxa that crossed the PT boundary. So if you look at this At this diagram, you will see the species that crossed actually the PT boundary, and there's only two. It's Lystrosaurus, so that's Lystrosaurus. You have the first species, Makegai, a second species, Curvatus, that crosses the PT boundary, the Permian-Triassic boundary, and then you have the two Triassic species, Murrayi and Declivis. And the other species that crosses the PT boundary is Moschorinus. It's a therocephalian. And the others were never found before and after. Either you have like Myosaurus, the humidopoid that was found after the PT boundary, but never before, or you have taxa like Prosanosuchus that are found only before, but not after. But there's only Lystrosaurus and Moschorinus cross the PT boundary. And what's interesting is that Lystrosaurus makegai is very large. That's the size of Lystrosaurus makegai. And then Curvatus is a little smaller. And then Declivis and Murrayi are very small, about that size. So that's called the Lilliput effect. It's something that you see very often in species that survive mass extinctions. Because when you become smaller, basically, you need less resources. And also, smaller species are known to reproduce faster. And a faster reproduction means that you can adapt a changing environment much quicker. So that's probably the two things that saved Lystrosaurus. Also, Lystrosaurus is, at least the Triassic species, are known for burrowing. So probably also Lystrosaurus was a burrowing species and it could hide and estivate or hibernate for a long period of time without eating or doing anything. And the last group of Dicynodon that we will talk about today is the Cadmeyeriformes, so the most derived Dicynodontoidea. They are easily recognizable by their very broad snout. The snout is much broader than the frontal region. So that's what is written here. The nasal is much broader than the frontals, and it's because of the presence of large horns on the nasals. It's much it's better visible here, actually, on Stalkeria particularly. You can see the nasals are very broad compared to the frontals here. And same thing here, you have the nasals very broad, and here you have the frontals here. So they are as broad or broader than the frontals because of the presence of the horns. And also the snout is much larger than the frontal region because of the overdeveloped maxillary process, caniniform process of the maxilla. You can see it here in Placerias. You have a very, very large... this is not the tusk, by the way. This is the caniniform process of the maxilla that is overdeveloped in Cadmeyeriformes. And Cadmeyeriformes are also recognizable by their very high sagittal crest here. And the sagittal crests, in which you will find your pineal foramen that is completely pinched between the two ridges here of anterior to the sagittal crest. So it's funnel shaped. Because of that, it's funnel shaped. And that's very characteristic of Cadmeyeriformes, a funnel-shaped pineal foramen. Instead of being nice and round, it's actually pinched like this and funnel-shaped. And the temporal openings are extremely large, extremely big in Cadmeyeriformes. So that's also a signature character of Cadmeyeriformes. And the Cadmeyeriformes were the last surviving Dicynodont in the Middle Triassic up to the Late Triassic and before Dicynodont become completely extinct at the end of the Triassic. So the last group for today is the Gorgonopsia, and we will talk very quickly about them. So first, you can see that the Gorgonopsia are located quite high on the tree. They are the sister group to Pterocephalia and Cynodonts, and the mammals are there, so they are quite high on the tree. And the Gorgonopsia are easily identifiable because they are, well, first, they are carnivorous, and they have a saber-like canine. So that's what you can see here in Smilosaurus. They have a very big, overdeveloped canine that is saber-like. So they were the first saber-like, saber-toothed mammal, the first saber-toothed animals, long before the saber-toothed tigers of the Cenozoic. The skull looks flat when you look at it from the side, like this. That's very characteristic of Gorgonopsia, a very flat skull. It also looks flat when you look at it from the top, because the two temporal fenestra are not so big, so they are very far apart from each other. You can see that there is a broad intertemporal region that is completely flat, and that makes the skull of Gorgonopsians quite easily recognizable. Another important character is the presence of an almost vertical ridge on the lower jaw, on the angular. So this is the reflected lamina of the angular. Here you can see it's massive, and you have that ridge here that you don't have in any other group of therapsids. One single ridge oriented almost vertically. Oh, and by the way, I should have changed that line. Almost vertical ridge on the reflected lamina. Sorry, my bad. This is a remnant from a previous presentation. Sorry. So yeah, an almost vertical ridge on the reflected lamina. And on the vomer, so when you flip the skull, you look at the palate, and here you will see on the vomer, there are three ridges on the vomer, 1, 2, 3. So there's like a fork on the vomer that is very well visible when the palate is prepared. Of course, you need the palate to be prepared to be able to see that. Another feature that may help you if you have a lower jaw is the lower jaw is usually very deep, especially at the symphysis, on the mental region, the region of the chin. The chin is very deep. It looks like a hammer almost. And Gorgonopsians, the phylogeny of Gorgonopsian is heavily debated, but recently it has developed into quite a consistent signal, and it's that the basalmos Gorgonopsians here are all from Russia, and they are quite gracile. If you look at the skull, it's very gracile. You can see the postorbital bar is thin, the jugal arch is very thin. You have that chin that is already deep, but it's not as deep as the one that we will see just after that. So the there is a Russian basal group of Gorgonopsians, and then it develops into the African clade of Gorgonopsians that you find only in South Africa or in Tanzania. Most of the Gorgonopsians were found in South Africa and Tanzania, and particularly in the African clade, you find the ruby gene, which are extremely robust as opposed to the Russian Gorgonopsians, with a very big, very thick postorbital bar, very thick jugal arch, bosses, pachyostotic bosses on top of the orbit, and a squamosal flange here that goes almost as low as the canine. So you can see the squamosal flange completely recovers the lower jaw in lateral view. So that big squamosal flange is typical of the ruby gene. So in between, you have a lot of species that are intermediate between these two morphologies. You also have extensive convergent evolution between some of the Russian Gorgonopsians, particularly Inostrantsevia, that looks very much like the big ruby gene of South Africa. So there is a lot of debate, and once again, that phylogeny is not well settled. As I was saying, it's just that there is a trend developing in interpreting the phylogeny of Gorgonopsian this way, but of course there is no consensus yet. Which leads us to the Eutheriodont, Therocephalia, and Cynodontia, but this will be for next time. Thank you very much, and see you tomorrow for the Eutheriodontia. Cheers!